complement deficiencies. When we have deficiency in one of the complement proteins or multiple deficiencies, we have susceptibility to pyogenic infections by encapsulated bacteria, similar to antibody deficiency. The presentation is less severe when the deficiency in the early components of complement system, C1, C2, C4, but it will be more severe if there is a deficiency of terminal components, including the C3, which is the common pathway, or the membrane attack complex. Acquired reduction in serum C3 and C4 or both can occur, okay, rather than inherited deficiencies. For example, a consumption of complement system can occur in autoimmune disease like systemic lupus, for example, or infections, especially severe infections and septicemia, can be associated with consumption of the complement proteins. So complement deficiencies can be acquired and can be inherited. Inherited complement deficiencies, which are usually autosomal recessive mutations, we have different deficiencies, maybe in early components like C1, C4, and C2. And the C1 has these subclasses Q and R and S. So there is high susceptibility to encapsulated bacterial infections, and they can also associated with autoimmunity like systemic lupus. C3, when deficient, there is susceptibility to severe biogenic infections. The membrane attack complex from C5 to C9 will be associated with recurrent Neisseria infections, meningitis, and meningococcemia. And remember this, it's frequently asked. Also, factor D and factor berberine, where we have here the initiation of the alternative pathway. So its deficiency will be associated with recurrent Neisseria infection. Factor H and factor I, they are the down regulator of complement system. Their deficiencies also can be associated with biogenic infections. And please remember the atypical hemolytic uremic syndrome, the genetic form of hemolytic uremic syndrome, and the thrombotic thrombocytopenic purpura. Deficiencies of these regulators of complement system result in continuous activation of the system and this recurrent inflammatory condition. Decay accelerating factor, also one of the regulators of complement system on the cell surfaces. Its deficiency renders the cells susceptible to complement mediated lysis of the cells and presented by the paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria, where we have recurrent hemolysis and thrombosis, liability to thrombosis. C1 inhibitor also one of regulators, as we have mentioned. Its deficiency present with the hereditary angioedema. Okay, it is not immune deficiency syndrome, but this is hereditary angioedema that carries an autosomal dominant mutation, can have a family history. Deficiency of this regulator will result in spontaneous activation of the classic component pathway, a complement pathway. Okay, so the classic pathway started, if you remember, by C1, followed by activation of C2 and C4, ending by the common pathway at C3. By the C3 convertase and its conversion into C3A and the C3B that mediates the immune response. When we have deficiency of C1 inhibitors, so continuous spontaneous activation of the classic pathway will occur, result in recurrent attacks of facial and airway periorbital edema. Like this, we have here periorbital edema, mucous membrane edema, laryngeal wall edema also can occur. Gut wall edema can present with abdominal pain. Also limb swelling can occur. These swellings progress over 1 or 2 hours and spontaneously subside over 2-3 days with characteristically no response to antihistamines, adrenaline, or steroid. It's not allergic reaction. Okay, so no response to these measures of treatment. The seriousness is in the laryngeal edema that can be fatal due to upper airway obstructions. It has triggers in the form of trauma, surgery, dental procedures, cold exposure, and anxiety stress. And please remember menses as a trigger in females. Present in older children and teenagers usually. Okay, and tend to persist throughout lifetime. Okay, family history is common. It is autosomal dominant phenomena. The characteristic finding is low C3 level during the attacks, but it's normal in between. C1 inhibitor level may be measured and found to be low. The priority for management is the airway management in case of laryngeal edema by intubation maybe and support of the airway. Then we have said no response to anti-allergic measurement. The treatment should be by the C1 inhibitor concentrate. Okay, if not available, this concentrate, so fresh frozen plasma infusion may be used. Prophylactic treatment in the form of danazol may be given in case of frequent attacks. About hypersensitivity reactions, okay, we know we have four types of hypersensitivity reactions. We may have a small idea about them, starting with type 1 that immediate reaction that occur on the second exposure to certain antigen. On first exposure to certain antigen, production of IgE antibodies specific for this antigen will occur, and then on second re-exposure, IgE will recognize the antigen and then bind to mast cell, causing their degranulation, release of histamine and other inflammatory mediators will occur, giving us the allergic reactions, and in the most severe condition can present with the horrible presentation of anaphylaxis. Allergic conditions associated with high IgE levels or IgE-mediated reactions are called atopy or atopic reactions. These include the allergic conjunctivitis, allergic rhinitis, maybe food allergy, asthma, and eczema. Type 2, it's called the cytotoxic hypersensitivity reaction that mediated also by antibodies and the complement activation. The classic example for cytotoxic reaction is the mismatched blood transfusion or autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Type 3, that it's called immune complex hypersensitivity reaction, characterized by immune complex formation, antigen-antibody immune complex that fix complement. Okay, and consumption of complement during a reaction will cause low complement levels. The classic example is the post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis associated with immune complex deposition in glomeruli with low C3 levels and the normal C4 levels. The another classic component example is lupus nephritis, where we have during the attack of lupus activity, low C3 and the C4 levels both. Okay, type 4 hypersensitivity, which is called delayed type hypersensitivity, that's not immediate, have delayed onset of presentation. This is mediated, okay, it's a cell mediated immunity, no rule for humoral immunity. Classic examples are contact dermatitis. You may ask it about someone developing reaction of and he use latex gloves, for example, or he is working with benzene, kerosene, and so on. This is contact dermatitis, and this is a type of cell-mediated or delayed hypersensitivity reaction. The other classic example is tuberculin scan testing. When we inject the purine, the BBD intradermal, and then wait for about 48 to 72 hours to look for the hypersensitivity response in the form of induration and measuring its diameter and so on. Okay, so these are the hypersensitivity reaction. About vaccinating the immunocompromised child. Having immunocompromised child, live vaccines are contraindicated in those patients, especially with severe T-cell deficiency, as they can cause severe disease. These include cases with severe combined immune deficiency, with Albrecht, CD4 ligand deficiency, lead, and HIS. All these should avoid live vaccines. BCG also, vaccine should, it is a live vaccine, okay, live attenuated, should not be given to patients with chronic granulomatous disease. Okay, remember that tuberculosis is a granulomatous disease associated with non-caseating granuloma as a characteristic lesion. So those patients are specifically prone to tuberculosis disease. Live vaccines also not to be given when receiving chemotherapy or immune suppressive drugs for whatever cause. Live vaccines should be avoided. Defer or delay vaccines for at least 3 months when receiving IVIG for any cause, maybe attack of myocarditis, maybe Guillain-Barré syndrome, maybe a case of antibody deficiency receiving periodic IVIG. When giving IVIG, vaccines will not be beneficial, okay, as they will be attacked by the infused immunoglobulins. So defer vaccines for at least 3 months. Also defer any measurement for the for immunoglobulin levels for at least 3 months. Cases with sickle cell disease, with nephrotic disease, with malnutrition, with chronic illness should receive protection in the form of pneumococcal and influenza vaccines. Okay, if they are not part of the routine immunization. These are influenza is a killed vaccine, okay, not cause a disease, and the pneumococcal is a polysaccharide vaccine. It is not a true organism, so they can be given in cases with immune deficiency. Post-splenectomy, very important. We have immune deficiency state post-splenectomy for whatever cause. So protection with pneumococcal, hemophilus influenza, and the meningococcal vaccine, all are polysaccharide vaccine, should be given with their booster doses to guard against infection with encapsulated bacteria. Also, lifelong antibiotic prophylaxis in the form of oral penicillin or erythromycin should be given for those cases post-splenectomy. To me, consider varicella zoster vaccine to seronegative family members. Okay, the family member contacting the immune compromised child should be screened for immunity against the varicella. If they are not immune, if they are seronegative, so they should receive the vaccine to guard against acquisition of the infection and its transmission to the immune compromised child. Immune suppressant medications are given for different causes, including post stem cell transplantation for cases maybe with leukemia or other autoimmune phenomena. You should have an idea about them and their side effects. For example, like corticosteroids, all of us know what are the side effects of corticosteroids. They are given post transplant to prevent the graft versus host disease. Also, cyclosporin is immune suppressive drug that also given to prevent graft versus host disease, and used also in different autoimmune diseases. But you should know that can be complicated by nephrotoxicity, hirsutism, and hypertension. Very important, you should follow these. Tacrolimus, also one of immune suppressive drugs used to prevent rejection, can be complicated by nephrotoxicity, neurotoxicity, and cardiomyopathy. Okay, mycophenolate mofetil, used in cases of nephrotic syndrome and to prevent rejection, both the transplantation and other autoimmune phenomena, can be complicated by marrow suppression and leukopenia. Azathioprine also prevent rejection and used to in different autoimmune phenomena, specifically systemic lupus, for example, and autoimmune dermatological diseases. So bone marrow suppression also and hepatotoxicity can be a side effect. Have an idea about monoclonal antibodies used in different inflammatory conditions. For example, we have the rituximab. Rituximab is monoclonal antibody targeting the clone of B cells. B cells carry the cluster differentiation number 20. Okay, so it is an anti CD20 antibody. Okay, we can use it in cases of B cell lymphoma and lymphoproliferative disease associated with B cell proliferation. Okay, if you remember, in case of ITP or immune thrombocytopenic purpura, one of the lines used for resistant ITP was the rituximab anti CD20. Also, in other conditions associated with autoimmune disease, rituximab that attack B cells will reduce the production of immunoglobulins in these cases. Infliximab, okay, is an important monoclonal antibody target tumor necrosis factor alpha, and so it's used as nowadays one of main lines for treatment of rheumatoid arthritis, juvenile rheumatoid arthritis, and Crohn's disease. Very important, and an alternative to infliximab is the etanercept in case of failure of infliximab or in development of side effects. So etanercept targets the tumor necrosis factor alpha receptor. Okay, also can be used in the same conditions as infliximab. Anti-thymocyte globulin targets the T cells. It can be used in cases we want to do T cell depletion. Okay, so this was an idea about this. About hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, we can get stem cell to use that for transplantation from bone marrow, okay, from peripheral blood, Okay, and from umbilical cord blood through the umbilical cord banks, blood banks. Umbilical cord stem cells has the advantage that they cause less graft versus host disease, okay, where the transplanted cells attack the recipient. They have faster immune reconstitution after transplantation, but being of lower number, they are of limited use in older children. We can use it in smaller ones or younger children. Donor source of stem cell can be autologous or allogenic. Autologous, where we get the stem cell from the patient himself. He may be a patient with leukemia, and before initiation of the chemotherapy, we may get a sample of his stem cell to reinfuse it after intensive chemotherapy or radiotherapy to rescue the hematopoietic system being very suppressed after initiation of therapy. Allogenic sources can be from a matched sibling donor. This offers the best outcome among all donor sources. If we need a donor, so a matched sibling is the best one. If it's not, he is not available, so matched family donor. In consanguineous family may be present, if not available, so haploidentical parent, the third one, and finally matched HLA matched unrelated donor may be the source, or unrelated cord blood units can be the source for stem cell transplantation. We need stem cell transplantation in case of leukemia after relapse, in case of primary immune deficiency, in case of hematological disease like Fanconi anemia, thalassemia, sickle cell disease. These are genetic diseases. Okay, that require stem cell transplantation. Some inborn error of metabolism also requires stem cell transplantation, but it has complications. Unfortunately, these complications can be early or late. Early complications include transmission of infection, okay, either bacterial, fungal, viral. Please remember cytomegalovirus as a common transmitted infection after transplantation. Also, Epstein-Barr virus and adenovirus, this has a specific importance. Early complication also can be graft versus host disease, where T cells in the graft itself is that attack the patient, okay, presenting with skin rashes, with liver impairment, elevation of liver enzymes is very characteristic, and derangement of liver function, and the GIT involvement, okay. Graft failure or graft rejection, where patient's immune system attack the graft. Okay, and in those cases, management will be in the form of giving immune suppressive medication, increasing the dose of immune suppression. Complications may be of immune suppressant itself used after transplantation and for life. Okay, these include cyclophosphamide, for example, has a complication of hemorrhagic cystitis, okay, presenting with hematuria, may be severe, may cause urinary tract obstruction by thrombosis. So plenty fluids should be given in conjunction with the cyclophosphamide treatment. Also, L-asparaginase therapy, one of immune suppressive drugs known to be associated with thrombotic disease or veno-occlusive disease, so anti-thrombotic measurements should be taken with its treatment. Late complications may be in the form of chronic graft versus host disease that can be, this graft versus can be acute, even on the table, can be subacute later on, or can be chronic. In chronic cases, presenting with skin rashes, gut manifestations, liver derangement, maybe bronchiolitis obliterans, we have mentioned it in the chapter of chest, cytopenias also may occur. Incomplete immune reconstitution can be a complication. Gross retardation can be a complication. As we have mentioned, increasing the dose of immune suppression would be the solution. Now let's systematize our brain and let's gather our information. What about the workup of a suspected immune deficiency disorder? Okay, so initially when you suspect that someone has immune deficiency, you can do the initial screening test in the form of full blood count with differential, very important to get the absolute neutrophil count. to diagnose neutropenia with levels less than 500 per cubic millimeter per liter, and to get the absolute lymphocyte count, having lymphocyte count less than 2,500 in an infant is not normal at all. Okay, so full blood count is differential. Blood film may show how Jolie bodies that are associated with aspirinia or cases of hypospelenism or post-spelenectomy maybe. Then you may measure the immunoglobulin levels, starting usually with the IgA level, as IgA usually the most common IgA deficiency. If it's normal, it's unlikely to have a new immunoglobulin deficiency. If it's deficient, you would search for the Ig levels, including IgG, IgA, and IgE. IgM. Okay. One of initial screening tests, especially for infant, may be HIV testing, as the most common HIV presentation in children is transmitted from the mother. Okay, is a maternal transmission disease. So test the HIV by HIV antibodies and the PCR for HIV. Chest X-ray in an infant would be very important to search for the thymic shadow. It's absent in cases of gamma globulinemia, in cases of severe combined immune deficiency, and in case of Di-George syndrome. Further testing depend on the clinical situation will be in the form of, again, Ig levels, immunoglobulin levels, searching for antibody deficiency. You may complete this by searching for functional antibodies or antibody response to vaccines, including diphtheria, tetanus, and haemophilus influenza vaccine. If we have immunoglobulin deficiency, so after vaccination with these, which are killed vaccine and the polysaccharide vaccine, they are not dangerous at all in case of immune deficiency. So searching for antibody response to these vaccines would be beneficial to guard if we have antibody deficiency or not. Also, as a confirmation, you may measure level of isoheme agglutinins after the age of 12 months, okay? Depending on the blood group, you may search for anti-blood group A or anti-blood group B antibodies, okay, to which are called the isoheme agglutinin to guard antibody deficiency. Or to diagnose antibody deficiency. After this, after you measure the immunoglobulin level, antibody response to vaccines, isoheme agglutinins, you may search for the lymphocyte disorder. Okay, count it first. Okay, by lymphocyte subpopulation using the flow cytometry. So we have get absolute lymphocyte count if we have lymphopenia. So we will go forward to get the lymphocyte subpopulation. By flow cytometry, we can get the CD3. CD3 is a cluster of differentiation defining the naive T cells before its maturation into CD4 and CD8. So it will be deficient, okay, in case of severe combined immune deficiency. That is characterized by severe cellular deficiency. By flow cytometry, we can get CD3, CD4, the 4T helper cells. So that's markedly reduced in cases of HIV, for example, and also in case of cellular deficiency, whatever goes. CD3, CD8 also, cytotoxic T cell. Okay, you may have deficiency of CD4 alone, or you may have deficiency of CD8. Okay, so we need to count. The ratio between CD4 and the CD8 is very important. And in case of HIV, we have characteristically a reversed ratio between CD4 and the CD8. Normally, CD4 is higher than CD8, but in case of HIV, due to marked reduction in CD4 numbers, so reversed ratio with low with higher CD8 values. Okay, finally, you search for the B lymphocyte abnormality by CD19 and 20. Marked reduction in B lymphocytes can be detected in cases of X-linked gamma globulinemia. Okay, after getting the numbers, if they all are normal, now you would search for abnormality in functions. Okay, so doing lymphocyte proliferation testing using what's called the mitogen responses to get abnormalities in the lymphocyte function. Then testing for neutrophil function if the clinical situation suggests phagocytic disorder. So testing the neutrophil function would be appropriate. We have mentioned the nitro low tetrazolium test, superoxide assays, and testing for chemotaxis. Then finally, with test for complement deficiency, you can do immunoassays measuring the levels of C3, C1, C2, C4, C5. You can measure levels of all these to detect deficiencies, or you can do the total hemolytic complement activity assay, okay, which measures the total complement activity using the CH50 for the classical pathway or AP50 for the alternative pathway to diagnose complement deficiency. C1 inhibitor levels are beneficial to diagnose cases with hereditary angioedema. Finally, molecular DNA studies or gene testing can be beneficial if available for different immune deficiency disorder. Now, let's go to approach to common clinical presentations with immune deficiency. If you have an infant with recurrent infections and failure to thrive, an infant, okay, you would know that maternal antibodies wane after 6 months after birth. So recurrent infection before 6 months, you should consider T-cell deficiency or phagocytic deficiency rather than antibody deficiency. A neonate or young infant with primary in immune deficiency can present with maybe recurrent bronchiolitis, maybe oral candidiasis, persistent and refractory, maybe intractable diarrhea, skin rash, very important, and persistent lymphopenia, less than 2,500, suspect severe combined immune deficiency. When a male present with recurrent infection added to this bleeding tendencies, thrombocytopenia, microplatelet, and eczema, so suspect Westcott-Albrecht syndrome. If you have delayed separation of umbilical cord, so suspect lead or leukocyte adhesion defect. If you have recurrent perianal abscess, fistula, or skin abscess, suspect a phagocyte disorder, like neutropenia, or abnormality in neutrophil function. Complicated BCG score and the disseminated BCG, very, very important to suspect a chronic granulomatous disease or SCID, severe combined immune deficiency. So your basic workup, we have mentioned the basic workup, starting with the full blood count with differential and the lymphocyte subset with flow cytometry, immunoglobulin levels with response to different vaccines, okay, and HIV testing, very important. If you have a child who has recurrent sinopulmonary infections in the form of recurrent otitis media, sinusitis, bronchopneumonia, and recurrent bronchopneumonia in a child with PID can end by chronic parenchymal damage and bronchiectasis, very important. So in a child presenting with recurrent sinopulmonary infection, please think of secondary causes for immune deficiency first, for disease presentation first. He may have atopy in the form of allergic rhinitis or asthma. He may have cystic fibrosis. He may have structural abnormality in the form of sequestered lung lobe, maybe in the form of ciliary dyskinesia, maybe in the form of congenital cystic adenomatoid malformation, maybe. Okay, so search about this. He may have aspiration, recurrent aspiration due to swallowing dysfunction in case of neurological abnormalities like cerebral palsy, for example, or he may have gastroesophageal reflux causing him this recurrent sinopulmonary infections. But you may think of primary antibody deficiency as a cause when you have recurrent pneumonia by encapsulated bacteria, pneumococci, Haemophilus, and Moraxella. Moraxella is a very important causative organism in case of otitis media. Cellular deficiency also can be suspected in these cases if you have opportunistic viral or fungal infection besides the bacterial pneumonia. We have also mentioned the basic workup for this, but please start with the sputum culture and TLC with differential get the lymphocyte count, get the IG immunoglobulin pattern, levels of immunoglobulins and its subclasses also of IgG, and measure the functional antibody, anti-diphtheria, anti-tetanus, anti-hemophilus influenza antibody. If the child received the vaccines, measure the total hemolytic complement complement activity or assay for C3 and C4 to diagnose complement deficiency that can be associated with recurrent sinopulmonary infections, get the lymphocyte subset T and B cell count by flow cytometry, please screen for the cystic fibrosis by sweat chloride testing and the genetic testing for the characteristic mutation delta F508, please do CT chest and the sinuses, okay, to get the complication of chronic lung disease and the chronic sinusitis. If you have a child with recurrent skin abscess, okay, please consider first the atopic eczema as a cause, okay, and other chronic dermatosis, like also consider diabetes mellitus, chronic hyperglycemia, consider staph colonization. Some families have inappropriate staph colonization, and then eradication of staph colonization would be very helpful in preventing recurrent skin infections, okay. If no, okay, then consider phagocytic disorder as a cause. And this may include congenital neutropenia or abnormality in the function, lead and chronic granulomatous disease. Also, recurrent skin abscess is associated with Westcott-Albrecht and associated with hyper IgE syndrome that characteristically have very high levels of IgE and eosinophils, plus the skin rashes and the skin and pulmonary infections. So the same workup, starting with TLC and differentials, platelet count for Westcott-Albrecht, blood film, okay, blood glucose to exclude diabetes, skin swab to exclude colonization with staph, and IG pattern also including the IgE level. In case of recurrent fungal infection, this can be oral or perianal candidiasis. And this, as you know, is very common in newborn and young infants, but it's usually not severe and usually responsive readily to antifungal ointment or creams. But if it's persistent, if it's extensive, so you should suspect immune deficiency. Mucocutaneous candidiasis and invasive fungal infections are common in immune-compromised, any immune-compromised patient who may receive chemotherapy or immune suppressive drugs for different causes. Immune suppression will be associated with invasive fungal disease or mucocutaneous candidiasis. But it can be opportunistic fungal infection in case with primary immune deficiency. These include the yeast infection by Candida or Cryptococci. Cryptococci, one of condition associated with meningitis, very important. Also associated with granulomatous disease appearing in the CT brain. So yeast infection may be Aspergillus, okay, and you may remember the bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, okay, that is has high levels of immunoglobulin against Aspergillus as a diagnostic test, okay. So can be present also in case with BID. Mycosis and histoplasmosis are also opportunistic fungal infection. In these cases, please consider phagocytic disorder first as a cause, any abnormality in neutrophil number or function, or cellular deficiency like SCID, like DiGeorge, like hyper IgM syndrome. Consider also IgE common variable and chronic mucocutaneous candidiasis syndrome, either presenting as a separate entity called chronic mucocutaneous candidiasis, or it can be a part of a gene mutation causing the syndrome of APECED we have mentioned. Okay, the same workup you would do for diagnosis. So in all these cases, please take a careful history for the pattern and the frequency of infections. Remember that you have X-linked pattern in these cases, gamma globulinemia, chronic granulomatous disease, SCID, Westcott-Albrecht, and lymphoproliferative disease, boys who are susceptible to Epstein-Barr virus infection, associated complications, okay, including lymphoma. And some of these are autosomal dominant, like the hyper IgE syndrome. And then do examination carefully. And this table is very interesting from the essential notes of revision. Saying that you should do a detailed examination for those patients. General examination may show you have faltering growth and failing of or falling off scintile charts. Very important within immune deficiency case. He won't grow or develop normally. Wasting would be present, clubbing would be present in case of chronic lung diseases when developed. Skin examination, you may find eczema associated with hyper IgE syndrome and Westcott-Albrecht syndrome. particularly also in Westcott Albrecht and lymphoproliferative scars of perianal fistula, maybe suspect chronic granulomatous disease, warts, okay, suspect hyper IgE, paper thin scar and poor wound healing, okay, in case of lead, disseminated BCG, don't miss chronic granulomatous disease or SCAD, for example, telangiectasia, very important, ataxia telangiectasia, hypopigmentation, and Chediak-Higashi syndrome, okay? Dysmorphic features, okay, present in case of DiGeorge syndrome, for example, and other syndromes. Eyes may get telangiectasia in case of ataxia telangiectasia. Ears also recurrent sinopulmonary infection associated with the antibody deficiency and complement deficiency also. So chronic draining of ears and perforated tympanic membrane will be present. Oral cavity for oral candidiasis, phagocytic and cellular deficiency, periodontitis and gingivitis usually associated with phagocyte or neutrophil abnormality, absent tonsils, okay, and other lymphoid tissues in case of SCID, severe combined, or X-linked agammaglobulinemia. Also, don't miss the absent thymus in case of SCID and DiGeorge. For chest, bronchiectasis would be present in case of antibody deficiency and the chronic lung disease. Scars of chest drains also may be present for biogenic infections. Examine lymph node and the liver and the spleen. Very important having a case with generalized lymphadenopathy and the hepatosplenomegaly, generalized hyperplasia of reticuloendothelial system. This can be due to infection. Maybe it is a case of systemic megalovirus, cytomegalovirus, or infectious mononucleosis, for example. Or it can be granulomatous disease, as tuberculosis, for example, as chronic granulomatous disease, for example, as Wagner granulomatosis, for example, and so on. So this can be granuloma. This can be lymphoproliferation as complication. We have mentioned in a boy with X-linked lymphoproliferative disease after Epstein-Barr virus infection. Okay, or it can be malignancy. It can be leukemia or lymphoma. So examine them, very important. Joint disease also can be associated with infections and autoimmunity. And don't miss ataxia with ataxia telangiectasia and recurrent Neisseria meningitis. Do not miss the complement deficiency. Okay, so careful examination, very important. Finally, please remember secondary immune deficiency is by far the more common than primary immune deficiency. Malnutrition is very important to cause viral infections with HIV, very, very important, measles and Epstein-Barr. Preterm birth, very important. Some drugs, especially immune suppressive drugs. Radiotherapy, very important. Malignancy will cause this nephrotic syndrome, loss of antibodies, will cause this protein losing enteropathy, also loss of antibodies in the stool in case of protein losing enteropathy. Sickle cell disease causing hypospelenism by recurrent splenic infarction associated with immune deficiency since the very early beginning. As young as 2 months age have immune deficiency due to sickle cell disease. Asplenia can be congenital, or can be acquired after splenectomy or after a long-standing sickle cell disease. Diabetes mellitus also a cause. Chronic hyperglycemia is a cause for secondary immune deficiency.